Have you ever thought about what happens to the nearby air when you pull an ice cube tray from the freezer? What about when you activate a blow dryer? Or when you release butane gas from a lighter nozzle, then ignite it with a spark. These are just a few stunning examples of the everyday phenomena that you can see from a unique perspective thanks to Schlieren imaging, a technique that lets you peer into the hidden world of air. In today's video, I'm going to reveal how it works and show you how to do it yourself. Hey everyone, Rohan here. I hope you're doing alright, and welcome to Nexus. Before we get to the science, I want to mention a couple of quick things. First, thank you so much to everyone who's been helping me grow the channel by liking, commenting, subscribing, all that good stuff. I truly appreciate your support. And as a sort of gesture of my gratitude, I'll be announcing a very special giveaway later in the video that you won't want to miss, especially if you're curious about trying this technique yourself. So make sure you stick around to find out more. And second, I have more to say about the subject than I can fit into a single video, so I'll be making a part two to cover the rest. If you want me to address any specific questions or details in that video, let me know down below. With that said, let's dive into it. As visually striking as it is, Schlieren imaging relies on some very basic physics. At the heart of this technique is a property of light called refraction, so let's begin there. Refraction is the scientific term for the bending of light that occurs when it moves from one environment to another with a different density. There are countless examples and applications of refraction in everyday life. If you've ever noticed a straw apparently changing direction in a glass of water, used a camera, or even if you wear contacts or eyeglasses, then you've experienced the effects of refraction firsthand. And refraction works according to some predefined rules established by the physical principle known as Snell's law. Essentially, it states that if a ray of light passes from a less dense medium like air into a more dense one like water, its path will bend towards the normal line, which is an imaginary line that forms a right angle to the boundary and goes through the point where the light ray crosses over. On the other hand, if the light ray passes from the more dense medium to the less dense one, like from water to air, then it'll bend away from the normal line. In short, if all else is equal, light is refracted in one direction when it moves from low to high density, and the opposite direction when it moves from high to low density. And the greater the difference in density between the two materials, the more the light is bent. Importantly, light isn't just refracted when it moves from one material into another, but also when it moves between regions of varying density within a single material. For instance, all around us are continuously shifting and swirling pockets of air with fluctuating density. The density of any given region of air can be influenced by a number of factors like temperature, pressure, airspeed, and humidity. So if a ray of light encounters a change in air density, it'll be deflected from its original path ever so slightly according to Snell's law. And emphasis on slightly, because typically, differences in air density are tiny compared to the differences in density between two separate materials like air and water. As a result, the refraction caused by changing air density is so minimal that it's almost never visible to the naked eye. So the question then becomes, how do we amplify that small amount of refraction to make it visible? Well, that's exactly where Schlieren imaging comes in. Now, let's figure out what we need to prepare our setup and how it works. There are a number of possible configurations of this technique, each with its own unique list of benefits, drawbacks, and necessary components. Some variations use multiple mirrors, lenses, even lasers. I chose a small-scale arrangement that relies on a single mirror because it's cheap and simple, but still relatively powerful. It's so sensitive that it even lets you visualize body heat. This particular setup requires four main components: a point source of light, a concave spherical mirror, a knife or other blade edge, and a camera with a high zoom. The camera is kind of optional, but we'll get into that. Let's take a closer look at each of these components one by one. We'll build an understanding of how they all come together along the way. First, we need a point source of light, meaning all the light rays emerge from a single point and then travel out in all directions ahead of the source. In this demonstration, I use a flashlight that's modified with a circular piece of black construction paper that blocks all outgoing light except for a tiny hole. It may not seem like very much light is getting through, but in this case, less is more. As you can see in the actual clips of the effect, this tiny point of light is bright enough to illuminate the entire circular region that makes up the Schlieren image. The next component we'll need is a concave spherical mirror. The concave part is a technical way of saying that the surface of the mirror curves inwards, as a opposed to a convex mirror, which curves outwards. And the spherical part means that if you were to extend the curvature of the mirror's surface, it would form a sphere. These mirrors come with a specification called the focal length. The mirror that I'm using has a focal length of 1300 millimeters. Generally speaking, mirrors with longer focal lengths will give you sharper results, but you should still be able to get a clear Schlieren effect with a shorter focal length, down to a few hundred millimeters. The mirror is placed vertically along its edge. The region of interest is the air directly in front of the mirror. To help you gain a basic sense of how this mirror reflects light, take a look at this diagram. The green dot represents our point source of light, which is placed about twice as far as the focal length of the mirror. Since the focal length of my mirror is 1300 millimeters, I set up my flashlight about twice as far, or about 2.6 meters away. Light rays travel out in straight lines from the source until they reach the curved surface of the mirror. The mirror then reflects the light back in a curious way, focusing all the rays back down to a single spot known as the focal point, represented here by the red dot. If you've correctly set up your source of light at twice the focal length away from the mirror, the focal point of the reflected light should appear at about the same distance as the flashlight. If it does, then you've got the correct spacing. After they converge at the focal point, the light rays continue traveling onwards. If any of you want to purchase one of these mirrors so you can try this setup at home, I'll leave links in the description to some great options at different price points, including the one that I bought. Actually, that brings me to the giveaway I mentioned earlier. I want to enable you to experiment with this incredible effect yourself, so I'll be sending the same mirror I used in this video to a lucky subscriber chosen at random. Make sure you hit the red subscribe button below the video for a chance to win. The next component we'll need is a blade, box cutter, or other sharp knife edge. I'm using a simple razor blade in my setup. I should mention that if you decide to try this yourself, you should handle all components safely and with proper supervision. Now, I'll carefully position my blade so that it just barely clips the bottom edge of the spot of light at the focal point. But why? Well, we know from earlier in the video that a given ray of light passing through regions of air with varying density will be deflected one way or the other according to the rules of refraction. But we also know that the differences in air density are so subtle that this refraction usually can't be detected without some amplification. The purpose of the blade is to block the light rays that are refracted downwards from continuing on past the focal point, resulting in darker regions in those parts of the image. Meanwhile, rays that are refracted upwards are able to pass over the blade instead of being blocked, resulting in brighter regions. These contrasting dark and bright regions combine into an image that corresponds to the changes in air density in front of the mirror. The nice thing is, you can stop right here if you don't have the right camera to directly film the effect. Even before I introduce a camera into its proper place in the setup, you can already see a projection of the Schlieren image after the light passes the blade. But if you do have a suitable camera, that's even better. Personally, I attached a lens with a high zoom to my DSLR since the camera is placed almost 9 feet away from the small mirror. Place the camera in the path of the light on the other side of the blade, point it at the mirror, and make some fine adjustments to the camera angle, exposure, and focus until the entire mirror is evenly lit. You'll know that you're good to go when you can start to make out minor manufacturing defects in the surface of the mirror. Also, notice that the horizontal and vertical inversion that we saw in the projected image is no longer an issue. The optical properties of the camera lens flip the Schlieren image into proper alignment with the rest of the scene. Now, all that's left is to admire the breathtaking result in all its glory. Some of you might be wondering how I was able to get the colorful effect that you saw in the clips at the start of the video. I'll talk about that and more in part 2. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you want to catch that video and be included in the mirror giveaway. If you think I've earned it, please consider leaving a like on this video because it really does help the channel. And if you have any thoughts or questions about this topic or anything else, feel free to leave a comment down below. I'll be sure to read and respond to everyone. That's it for now. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.